There's been a real upswing in popularity for South Korean cinema, though we can trace a more enthusiast interest back to the films of Park Chan-wook, specifically his film Old Boy. The Academy Award for Bong Joon-ho certainly didn't hurt the wider popularity of South Korean film. That being the case, popular South Korean films come with expectations. There are certainly outliers to this, like Jeon Go-woon's beautiful and enduringly popular Microhabitat, but on the whole, South Korean film comes with an expectation of extremity. Your Vengeance trilogies, your Eyes of the Devils, your Train to Busan's, hell, even Parasite goes pretty hard, and even the meditative spring, summer, fall, winter, and spring is not without extremity. But my favourite South Korean director, yes, favourite, avoids this categorisation. Hong Sang-soo is out there making a different cinema, one very indebted to France's Éric Rohmer, but very different. His own cinema. At this point, I've seen every Hong Sang-soo film, including his shorts, and have become wholly fascinated for reasons I will expand on. The weird thing is, I now surprisingly often get asked what Hong Sang-soo film to start with. Every time I freeze up, part of it is the weight of 30 examples in my head and the pressure to get it right. A larger part of it, though, is that I'm not that interested in any of his films on their own. Now that sounds like I don't love his films. I love many of his films. I could easily list my favourites, The Day He Arrives, On the Beach, Night Alone, and Right Now, Wrong Then. But what's more interesting to me, what makes him a favourite director, and perhaps my favourite working director, as we know, Steven Soderbergh is retired, is the accumulation of his work. When somebody asks me what Hong Sang-soo film to watch, what I really want to say is, all of them. Every one. One isn't enough. Because, yeah, I might recommend, let's say, Right Now, Wrong Then, and they may love it. Fantastic. But then they wouldn't pick up on how that unique story structure, the bifurcated narrative, is actually not unique. It's the second time you structured a film that way, where you have the same narrative play out twice but with a few key differences and changes in perspective. His 2000 film, Virgin Stripped Bare by Her Bachelors, a hard film to recommend due to the name, but a great movie, also has this structure. In Right Now, Wrong Then, we see a repetition, and this is also a repetition that contains a repetition in it because we are seeing the same events again and again. Now, repetition is key to Hong Sang-soo's work, and therefore there is even more of a need to keep watching them, as the repetitions echo through wider films, not just the internal echoes. Virgin Stripped Bare by Her Bachelors is a key film in Hong Sang-soo's filmography. It's his third film, and the first for me that really feels like what I know as a Hong Sang-soo film. But let's flash back further. To reach the core of what is a Hong Sang-soo film, let's look at his debut, The Day a Pig Fell into the Well. Well, the title has a certain Hong Sang-soo verbosity to it, an oddness. That seems right. Not all of his films are like this, but his first five films definitely share a linguistic approach, title-wise. So, let's approach The Day a Pig Fell into the Well with Hong Sang-soo eyes, with the weight of 29 other works behind us, and see what we can glean, because on the surface, this is quite a divergent film. This debut actually has what I mentioned earlier, a bit of extremity. We have a horror-inflected score, and there are shocking moments. There is violence here. Fascinating to me, this film definitely feels like a work of imitation or inspiration, as do his wider works, both of themselves, a kind of knowing and postmodern self-plagiarism, but also of Éric Rohmer. This film, it's not that. This feels like director Hong's attempt to fit into the style associated with the Taiwanese New Wave, probably due to the relative proximity to the movement. This 1996 work feels like it's inspired specifically by Tsai Ming Liang's Rebels of the Neon God and Edward Yang's Terrorizers. It has that coldness, that undercurrent of brutality, that disaffection. It also has South Korean cinema staple Song Kang-ho, which is great to see. But there are Hongisms, even if the overall style isn't very Hong. So let's go through them. The first is static shots. Director Hong's later cinema can be defined by stripping cinema back to its bare essentials. People sit and talk and the camera watches them. They go off screen or stay on screen, the camera watches them. Occasionally it zooms in, more on that later, but this static frame is key to his style. We have some of this in his first film. Another point is the drinking of alcohol, usually soju. Your average direct-to-Hong film will include one scene of the characters getting drunk, usually on soju, and revealing all kinds of secrets. You see, the heart of a Hong Sang-soo film is its conversations. These conversations are your action scenes, often powerful because you know people are speaking at odds, speaking performatively or hiding realities from each other. What the soju does is work as a social lubricant. It is the thing that gets out the honest talk, the thing that produces the conflict. Another trope is returning actors. We also have the actor Kim Yoo-sung in this film. He returns a few times in Hong Sang-soo films. A thing Hong Sang-soo loves to do is repeat actors, now there's no surprise there, but he repeats them in really playful and interesting ways, putting an actor in a film in a way that evokes a previous film, hinting at some bizarre Hongian cinematic universe, or having them there to conjure up or subvert your previous expectations of them based on another Hong Sang-soo movie. So, what next? Structure. Structure may be the key reason why I love Hong Sang-soo films. You see, it's so easy to have the following conversation. Oh, I saw the new Hong Sang-soo film. Do people sit around and talk in static frames? Was it about a filmmaker or a creative and their abuse of power? Were there invasive zooms? Was it about men being trashed? Did they all drink soju? Oh, you've seen it? No, I've just seen all the rest. Yet, in spite of this overt similarity and knowing similarity, there is so much internal complexity. Anyway, structure. These films with such simple character-focused narratives often take part within really complex narrative structures, really atypical ones. Let's take Hill of Freedom, for example, a story composed from undated letters left by another character. The thing is, these letters are dropped and they scatter. Their order is lost. We therefore watch these narrative moments out of order, piecing things together ourselves. Or consider the structure of Ha Ha Ha, the forced laughter of the title being very purposeful. The film is two friends talking over drinks, that's all in colour, but they're telling stories. The stories are shown through black and white still photos, which seems somewhat inauthentic. What is actual story? What is storytelling? It is a film where love is spoken of frequently, but rarely expressed. All in all, it's a clever structural confrontation of our realities and fictions. The Day a Pig Fell into the Well is structurally messy. It lacks the precision of later works, but it's trying to show people as messy, therefore even in his early feature, the matching of form and content is there, a key Hongian technique. The last part of The Day a Pig Fell into the Well is its themes. Director Hong has a looping set of themes that are further refined through repetition. They come together as cinematic obsessions, and the way they occur and reoccur makes viewing each new film really satisfying. My ultimate point, I guess, is that Hong Sang-soo has forged his own genre, aided by the work of others, but still his own genre. We don't complain when a rock song has the features that make it a rock song. We like genre. We can be genre fans. But we still notice the room for almost infinite variation within that constrained space, and how constraints can breed creativity. The themes and techniques are Hong Sang-soo's scale, are his key devices, and his improvisations on these are fascinating. So what are the key themes or narrative fixations as already shown in his debut? Well, they are threefold. 1. Messy relationships. 2. The male capacity for cruelty, though perhaps better worded as how the patriarchy enables male cruelty. 3. The endemic victimization of women in society. Let's jump back to what I have categorized as the first true Hongian work then, to explore this classification further. Virgin Stripped Bare by Her Bachelors adds a new theme, one that is a real perennial Hongian feature, a meditation on cinema. Director Hong likes to have characters that are filmmakers, and these characters are often dictatorial men, or just Lotharios, who reflect toxic gender dynamics, cinema's ability to exploit, and asymmetrical power in general. It is worth noting that improvisation is a key part of Hong Sang-soo's films. These are films in which those within them are to an extent able to offer the piece. It is therefore interesting that the wider filmography presents conventional filmmaking as much more rigid and dictatorial as oppressive even. Though it goes back to the evergreen theme of art reflecting life and the artist, Hong Sang-soo films don't shy away from this. If our art will always reflect us, then Hong Sang-soo interrogates the artist, the artistic drive, the artistic process. The apex of this is in his phenomenal film, On the Beach at Night Alone, a film deeply in conversation with itself. This is a film made by Hong Sang-soo and starring Kim Min-hee, a frequent collaborator. It's about a woman, played by Kim Min-hee, that's had an affair with a married director. Sounds pretty Hong Sang-soo. The affair was discovered, the relationship ended, and now our protagonist has to live with that. Another thing that comes back to me time and time again is that Hong Sang-soo films are the films of aftermath, where most films have conflict at their centre. The work of Hong Sang-soo takes place after conflict, exploring the scars that form and how we are formed by the conflicts in our past. This is very much that movie. So, our protagonist is having to live with how everybody knows. It also confronts life beyond the lens. Her filmed life, her as an actor, has overspilled into her real life, and now her real life is becoming more metaphorically filmed, in that it is more observed. She is out of the eye of the camera, but now always in the judgmental public eye. An eye for an eye. This film uses Hong Sang-soo's trademark zooms, a feature brought in 2005's Tale of Cinema. The camera in a Hong Sang-soo film is so often, and so very purposefully, unintrusive. I'm reminded of the early cinema of Japan, which I've of course only read about, in which what was filmed was less important than what was performed. Filmed material will be rudimentary, the camera capturing what was in front of it like an audience member at a theatrical performance. The artistry comes from the benshi, the narrator who attends the screening of the film material. The material exists as background, the point is the benshi, who narrates and performs and brings it to life. The artistry is not within the form, it remains outside of it, as an extension of theatrics. So, Hong Sang-soo's films, on a surface level, feel unfilmic, until they definitely feel filmic. The zooms are so obvious, so demonstrative of the fact that what we are watching is being filmed, that there is a camera there, that it foregrounds the reality of cinema. It is not surprising that Tale of Cinema, a film about film that wants you to link the observations in it to observations about cinema, is the first to use this as a stylistic and intentional device. It's Brechtian. We are watching a film and are aware of it. This is used differently in each film, often to make us focus in on a moment, but in On the Beach at Night Alone is used to make us focus on form. We are voyeurs. We are invaders. We are the person looking in, focusing in. The film only covers aftermath, the private details of a woman's life, the details beyond her reality as a filmed object, as an actor. But we are watching. We are intruding. The zoom makes us uncomfortably aware. It confronts our complicity. But the zoom does something else in this film. It sticks the camera to Kim Min-hee and gives her autonomy. The camera just loves her, and the film as a whole is just matching her rhythms. Again, the improvisation mentioned earlier. Focusing in on her highlights invasiveness and her isolation, but it also demonstrates her importance. There is an empowering element to it. This, at every point, feels like Kim Min-hee's film. And this is all necessary because this whole film is deeply metatextual. You see, Hong Sang-soo had an affair with Kim Min-hee while he was married, and the relationship was discovered and thrust to the public eye. So the film is art imitating life. Art imitating life in a way that could be crude or exploitative, but is actually, in expression, really beautiful. This is not a film about the affair, or about the filmmaker, it is about the collateral damage, and is a sympathetic and open portrait of Kim Min-hee that confronts the viewer with the question of, is it any of their business anyway? Even sound is used to blur the lines between fiction and reality, as non-diegetic overlaps with diegetic, with characters even saying that a simple piece of music hides real complexity if you plunge its depths. This, like so many lines in Hong Sang-soo movies, are meant to reflect on the film itself and his wider films. It encourages the viewer to engage with the film, to interrogate it. It's advice for Hong Sang-soo's wider filmography. How simplicity, surface-level simplicity, is the genesis of complexity. So, maybe you should start your Hong Sang-soo journey with On the Beach Night Alone, but then that isn't as powerful if you don't recognise the themes from before, the actor from before, the tropes, both narrative and stylistic, have all occurred before. You also probably need to know that Hong Sang-soo already made a film called Woman on the Beach, a narrative where a director and a male figure are spiralling around this woman. Woman is the future of man, and bachelors do this as well, but Woman on the Beach actually foregrounds its female characters, serving as a wonderful precursor to On the Beach at Night Alone. So we definitely can't start with that movie. So, do we instead start with what I've said is the prototypical Hongian work? Virgin Stripped Bare by Her Bachelors. Now, Bachelors has a similar structure to Right Now Wrong Then, as I've said, but it's so different. The dual storylines in Bachelors are used to show the inevitability of oppression within patriarchal systems. The woman thinks she has a choice and options. Both options, to her, end up in a form of degradation. It's not nihilism. It's a recognition of how the patriarchy robs women of agency, but gives them the illusion of it. It's forced, though, as a message to an extent, and is a tale of feminine oppression from a very masculine point of view. This makes Right Now, Wrong Then a marvel. The female lead is empowered, and the repeating structure is made more interesting because it doesn't just repeat. When held against Bachelors, it becomes clear that Hong Sang-soo has made a subjunctive film, a film of possibility. We see a change in viewpoint, the extension of a theme that has fascinated a filmmaker finally brought to a conclusion. Early films focused on grim realities and the inevitability of degradation of certain systems. This film, hopeful, more humanist. But it's not a naive work. It's still a film that recognises things go wrong due to outside structures and systems, and that success is chance, and that chance is ultimately removed from us in so many circumstances. The people in this film interact prosaically, transactionally, conversations are evidently performative, and the world we see feels very real. But we have the Right Now section that follows the Wrong Then part. Things can work out, but the modal verb is key, can. Hong Sang-soo has not changed his mind on systemic oppression, he's just adding the caveat that we have potential for improvement. Things can be better. By itself, the message is lovely and important, but when considered as a cumulative message built up from a body of work, it's astonishing. An old framework comes back, and we see the progression of a person, not just an artist. Bachelors wasn't wrong in its observations, but it was narrow. Here, the scope is widened, so you can't start with Right Now, Wrong Then. But you probably don't want to start with Bachelors, and his first film is only interesting when considered against his other films, and On the Beach at Night Alone only displays its real power if you're familiar with the form of the Hong Sang-soo film of him as a creative. So where do you start? I mean, why not with my favourite film of his, The Day He Arrives? We have a distinct structure, three seemingly repeated days, and it's about a filmmaker. There you go, Hong tropes. Here, black and white photography is used to evoke falsity in cinema. Hong Sang-soo does this a few times, starting in Bachelors, so maybe having watched Bachelors would have... Damn it. Never mind. Anyway, The Day He Arrives, it's something about repetitions and uniformities, about being stuck in a rut. The black and white photography only adds to this, a sense of disconnect and the artificial. It's also a film about how one appears versus how one is. A film director is a big deal in this small village. He's returned to his past, but this is a regression. Regression is repeated to make this clear. An unhealthy love affair is restarted. The habit of smoking is restarted. He even woos a woman by lighting her cigarette, a classic old-fashioned cinematic symbol. And he's returned to his old town, old friends, etc. It's all a return to the past. And here he's cool. He's a director because he's made films, but he's also the director of the social situations around him. He has control. A central theme becomes the idea of a big fish in a small pond, the insecurity of the filmmaker. He returns to the comfortable past as a sign of his success, but also a want to control the past to control the more difficult present. At one point, he meets up with an actor who was in one of his films. He expects nostalgia. He gets a conversation about the metaphorical wounds the director inflicted upon the person, things the director was ignorant to. The comfortable past is denied from him, he needs to accept reality, but the film repeats because he is stuck in falsity. And we are tied to the lens of this filmmaker, pulled in there with him, his disaffected voiceover becoming numbing, but also a meta device, a knowing nod at the pretentious conventions of independent cinema. It's played out, boringly traditional, and the film knows it and pins it to the character. The classic zooms follow our character's attention, they denote his attentiveness, but also his selfishness. When another character enters a conversation and pulls attention away from the protagonist, the camera zooms out. If he doesn't get our full attention, we get distance. But the best moment of the film is a break from this, a moment that unravels the scope of the whole thing. Our camera moves away from the director and focuses on a woman he is talking to, and suddenly her internal voice breaks through. There is a wider world. We have been constricted, and this never happens again. But it so beautifully shows the insularity of our protagonist and how our view of his filmic world, of this filmic world, is only on his terms. So, start with this film. But it's a film of repetitions, and those repetitions are only heightened if you've seen the other repetitions, the film that is repeating. This is not only an internal reflection, it is part of an external puzzle. Maybe start with Claire's camera A 70-minute feature starring Isabelle Huppert, filmed during the Cannes Film Festival, a film of sheer reality but with a touch of magic. You see Claire's camera, not her knee, changes things. She says that it does. When she puts her camera on something, it changes things. But this isn't a magical realist device, it's a statement about the film and about Hong Sang-soo's cinema. The camera is placed on normality and does apply a change to it. The filmmaker gleans art from the prosaic. Claire tells us that a picture captures a moment and allows us to reflect. And this observation opens up Hong Sang-soo's cinema. It is a line that could be applied to his usage of zooms in general. It's a key. So you can't start here. You may think it's too slight and frivolous and not realise that it is in communication with a cinematic ethos. Why not in another country then? You get three stories that are ostensibly different but overlap key figures. So you get that subjunctive nature. And you also get Isabelle Huppert, it's always a bonus. It's about cultural and linguistic divides, and the divided structure only adds to this. What a great work then to get an insight into director Hong. Only this isn't his only film to have done that. All this would work better if you'd seen some other Hong Sang-soo films. In Another Country is about how transitory places alter identity, holiday destinations exist in liminality and therefore allow us to exist in even more performative ways. This is explored in The Power of Kangwon Province and in Woman on the Beach. But another work you would have had to see would be Night and Day, one of the pinnacles of Hong Sang-soo's explorations of male mediocrity. It approaches a linguistic and cultural divide, similarly to In Another Country, as our protagonist is in another country, France. It's a purgatorial, repetitive film in which the title becomes interestingly ironic, as the film seems to take place in a perpetual repetitive daytime. But early on, a Frenchman says how hard it can be to tell day from the night. This links back to the film's study of mediocrity and repetition, a theme pronounced by this being director Hong's longest film, and by using length to add thematic heft. But at this point, I could zoom in, like director Hong's camera, on any of his works and say how they contain all of his cinema, but are importantly different. Hell, I've written on Letterboxd about how his 2-minute-long filmed acceptance speech for the Silver Bear for Best Screenplay Award at the 2021 Berlin Film Festival is itself an encapsulation of his whole filmography. And that film is a short speech, text shown on screen, and then footage of a random snail that Hong Sang-soo discovered on a walk, which Kim Min-hee sings Que Sera Sera over. That's the short. That's it. But in it, you have his obsession with the melodies of speech, and the beauty of letting somebody talk. This is highlighted by a cappella singing. It's a song about banality, the everyday, but it's beautiful. And the camera lingers, finds beauty and poetry in just a snail being a snail. That's Hong Sang-soo's cinema, right there. We are watching through Claire's camera, and everything has changed. So, where do you start with Hong Sang-soo? Where do you go next? The actual answer is easy. Anywhere. As long as you don't finish there. That's what I always want to say. Watch this one, but then don't judge his filmography by it. Use it as a launchpad to the next and the next, because the films don't matter as much as how they intersect with each other matters. They don't matter as much as the combined repetitions and meditations matter. So start with whatever one really appeals to you that looks interesting, and then keep going. Look for the connections. Find your own, and explore a filmography that is more worthwhile than any of its constituent parts.